Okay, so process was, since we were on the active sprints, that was our first sprint. Now there is only one in progress, two are done. And we did how many tasks? At least 10 tasks we have done, right? But no tasks, all the tasks are in to-do, nothing in progress. So why this happened? Because you guys were not paying attention. You didn't pay much heed to this Jira board. Nothing moves without the zero. In actual moment, nothing moves with, you know, without this. If you are working on a task, it has to be listed here. It has to be, and you even have to sometimes put comments as well. Working on this, facing this issue, everything has to be documented. Whatever you're doing. So for example, Rupali was doing something, she was facing NPM problem. It has to be documented. Okay, it's that strict. In real moment, it's that strict. Usually, why you guys didn't do it? Because there was not any scrum master to do a daily scrum meeting. Usually these things are part of scrum meetings, that Jiras are updated, everything is there. If you're feeling some problem, you fill it there, then you know, assign something to someone, put some evidences, all those things. Even if you have created a PR request, the link of that PR request, you have to put in the comments that I've raised this PR request, it's for approval. I'll approve it. As soon as I approve it, you say PR approved, code merged, move to the development, and you're add a comment, yes, I have done this task or something like that. Just to put an evidence that my code is working and I have posted the link of some evidence, some reports, something here in the comment section. So from next time, that is next week onwards, follow this. Okay. Now what we do is, I will just move all the tasks here and I will consider it done. So let's assume, because we are done with the, because our sprint was 1 week, if you remember, right? It was 1 week, 1 week is over. Here it's coming as 0 days remaining, that means it's done. Okay, so I have to complete sprint. This was my first sprint. So I will go and move everything here. Oh, sorry, I should have been moving this to done. Okay, tell me what happened if I just go and complete the sprint. What will happen if I go and complete? This is the like valid interview question. So what happens? Everyone can see it. Let me make it bigger. Right. So this is usually called a spillover. So there was a sprint of 1 week. Everything has to be done in that 1 week. Why? Because we have done estimations. Remember, we were doing some pointing poker. We are giving some estimation points to it. And we are saying, okay, 5 people can do this. I've recorded that, by the way. If anyone missed that, you can see on YouTube. I recorded a session where I was explaining pointing poker estimations and all. So now, after all the estimations, I posted those tasks here. Okay. Now, there was some miss in the estimation. I didn't factor some aspect or some problem because of which my tasks were not completed even after the end of the sprint. So end of the sprint, I'm still left with, let's say, these two tasks. And I'm assuming that I'm done with these tasks. So I'll just, let me just quickly put it here. So all these tasks, let's say, are done. There were too many. Why I'm putting everything here? Because we are going to create new tasks again, because there are a few tasks which are still not done, but let's create it again, because this time we need to do something in a different manner in Git. So I'm just moving everything here. The board has been updated. Who updated it? Anyone also working in this? No, right? Okay, anyway. So now let's say these two tasks were in progress and because of some reason, they were not done. So what will happen? First thing is, you are bound to answer this question to an agile coach or your manager or some product owner, usually product owner. Because to the product owner, you committed that these are the things which I'm going to deliver in this sprint, which you were not able to. Right? So there will be an escalation. What is escalation? It's something, anything which goes to the higher level is usually called an escalation. So there will be an escalation. They will say why you were not able to do it. So then there will be a lot of retrospectives, lot of discussions. Was this important? So I'm not talking about testing, because in testing it's not that important, right? When you talk about the development, so I want to release a product, some functionality of the product, and I was not able to. And that functionality was very important. Like I always give example of Amazon or Flipkart. Both wants to launch MI phone. For launching it on my phone, there has to be some functionality in Amazon as well as on Flipkart. And that functionality was not being delivered in Amazon. And Flipkart was able to deliver that. So there will be huge business loss. It's a big, big revenue loss for Amazon because everyone was buying the MI product on Flipkart. Amazon lost the money. Getting it? So in such cases, things become very sensitive. So you cannot afford to do that. But what is the remedy for this? So you can say, now this is like as an interview question, what will you do if this happens? You can say, okay, this should have found earlier. So I was having 1 week. I should have known by Wednesday or Thursday that I will not be able to deliver it. How? We keep on discussing. That's the purpose of Scrum call. In Scrum call, you keep on telling or explaining or discussing the challenges which you are facing. Now, if you're telling me this on Friday, last day of the sprint, I'm not able to do it, then your agile principles are not being implemented properly. That's the only answer. Because in agile, you detect problems prior to it being happening. Getting it? So we should have known why these tasks are not done. Okay, but still, let's say I'm able to find this out on Wednesday that I'm not able to deliver these, but still I have to deliver these two important functionalities. What will I do? I will say, okay, these two tasks which are almost done, let's not do it. Let's focus all our efforts on these two tasks, which has to be delivered. Getting it? So the actual interview question is, what will you do if you are at the end of the sprint, you realize this cannot be done, right? If this is happening with you, your answer should be, first of all, it's a wrong scenario. Why? Because I should have known it earlier. I should have identified, my Scrum Master, our team should have identified earlier that I will not be able to deliver it. Okay? That usually will happen. It will never happen that on the last day you're realizing it can't be done. You always know. Once you start working on it, you will realize the complexity of it. If you're not able to, you know, identify that problem for whatever reason, and it actually has come down to this level where it's the risk of spillover, then you can say, I will spend extra time on it. I will ask other teams to spend time on it. Right? And let's say still the interviewer will say, okay, it's not possible to do in the weekends also. So what will you do now? So the answer should be, I will not do anything. I will make it spillover. So it will be spilled over to the next sprint, depending on what kind of severity or what kind of priority it holds. Getting it or not getting it? Ask questions, guys, ask questions. If you think I am being ambiguous, you can ask questions. Am I being ambiguous here? Clear? So, yeah, question. So, the two kind of scenarios. One, where the task or a story or whatever it is, it's not of high priority. If it is not of high business priority, you make it, you let it spill over. Okay, I'm not able to do this. I accept my mistake. I did my estimations wrong. We will learn from this mistake in the next sprint. So you let it spill over. Second case is, it's very business sensitive and you're not able to deliver it. Then only choice is, you detect it earlier. So because in that sprint, the day one, you knew this functionality is very important. Right? Since you knew this functionality is very important, you will do that functionality first. So all your resource should be focused on doing that story. And if you get time, then you can do less important stories as well. And if your time is not permitting you to do that, then you will let less prioritized stories to get spilled over, but you still can deliver the most high priority functionalities first. Okay? That is the purpose of daily Scrum call. The daily Scrum call is not only about taking updates. The job of or role of a Scrum Master is to find out the blockers. So he take updates to know where the person is in terms of delivering the requirement in the stipulated time. If you're not able to deliver that requirement in that specified time, then that's the Scrum Master's responsibility. So usually in a sprint, the deliverables responsibility or accountability is with the Scrum Master because he has to manage it. He need to remove the blockers. He need to see, okay, this is a high priority. Someone else should be doing it and all those things. Or two people should do it. Or let's take help from somewhere outside the team. Or he can himself start doing it. So a lot of things, depending on who the Scrum Master and what skills he holds. Even a Scrum Master sometimes start doing things because he have to deliver it. Getting it? Clear? Now in this case, I'm assuming, let's say these three cases are not done. We are not able to do it. It's the last day of the sprint. I'm not able to do it. So I will say, okay, complete sprint. As soon as I do complete sprint, these two stories will either go to a backlog or they will go to a next sprint. So I have already planned it. So if let's say, I'll keep this and I will say new test case, get products less than or equal to one. So I'll keep it. I'm not able to do it. We team, we people. So like come back to our original team structure. So you guys were there. I was your scrum master or team leader, whatever you wish to call me. And this is the last day. This is a scrum meeting. And I'll say, okay, I'm not able to do that. Okay. I will hold someone responsible. Of course, we'll have to have a retrospective meeting. We'll have to talk to product owner and explain the reason why this wasn't done. That will come later. For now, I will just say complete sprint. Now, as soon as you do complete sprint, now Jira is asking me, so 70 issues were done. One issue was incomplete. Select where all the incomplete issues should be moved. So it's saying either you move it to sprint 4 or sprint 5, or you just move it to backlog. So if I want to do this task in the next sprint, it's important, then I'll say, okay, move it to sprint 4, because this is sprint 3. I want to move it to sprint 4 so that I would take it to the next sprint because it was midway. Or I would say, okay, this is not that important a task. Let's not move it to the next sprint. Let's move it to the backlog. So I will just mark it as backlog. It will go and move to the backlog. Now, what I'll see is a report. So as soon as you complete a sprint, you see reports. So last time we discussed there are different kind of reports. Depends on what kind of reports is acceptable within your team structure, what kind of reports is required for the product owner, and what kind of analysis you are doing. It depends on that. So it's not that all the reports are being sent to everyone. Reports are usually to judge how did you do in that sprint. How was your performance in terms of burning down the tickets on user stories? How did the team perform? Just to analyze that is, these reports are there. So sprint report, velocity chart, burn down chart. It has different utilities. You see there are different kind of release burn down, epic burn down. Burn down usually refers to how are you burning your tickets? How are you spending your time to burn down the ticket? Burn down means, let's say I've done 5 tickets or 5 Jiras. Every Jira has some story points associated with it. Right, so 5, 6, some are 8, not 6. So if we discussed this last time, we are using Fibonacci series, let's say. So your story point should be 1, 2, 3, 5, 8, not 7. Something like that. Okay. So how are you burning these tickets is what is this, this is being displayed. So in this case, why we are not seeing anything? Because in all the tickets which we have created, we didn't give any story points. So if there are no story points, if you're not giving any story points, then you will not be able to see few of these charts. Okay, you remember we did story points using pointing poker. We gave numbers, remember? I think most of you were there in that class. But we didn't associate those story points to the tickets which I just completed. So that's the reason I am not able to see these any of these charts. But this time, in the next sprint, we'll do that. Okay, let me go back to project backlog. So this was my backlog. This was my Apex test case development framework enhancement maintenance. All those things were there. Let me do one thing. Let me clear all filters. So I have these still remaining. So I want to do something for DB validation, XML manager, XML manager, JSON manager, log4j. This is the task which I was not able to complete in the last sprint. Okay. Now what next? So since I'm your scrum master, right? Let me drive this. So what is it which we need to do to automate? There are a few more tasks. Let's see that. So I am here, localhost 3030. So what I'm doing right now is creation of some backlog tickets, creation of some items, to plan what needs to be done in the next sprint. So I'm going into a planning session. What I'm doing right now is a planning session of my sprint. What are the tasks which I need to do? and what are the priorities of those tasks and who will I assign those tasks to. So all these things is what I'm doing right now. This is called as refinement session, sprint planning session, all those things. Okay. So we did with this. We only worked with products, remember? And we only did for Git. And trust me, whatever you did is not up to the mark. So what you did is just hitting the URL and checking 200 is coming or not, 200 is coming or not. That's not it. We need to do some validations as well. Okay. So I would say, let's discard all the work which you have done. Let that work in your branches, safe and sound. What we are going to do is we are going to create a new branch altogether. Okay. And in that branch is what we are going to follow complete end-to-end process. So this time again, we are going to create new test cases for Git as well as post. And in the same file, we need to make changes. Okay. If you're making changes in the same file, there might be a clash or conflicts. That is what we need to witness. We need to see that conflicts. I want you guys to face that conflict problem. Then only you will learn how to resolve those issues. Okay. Okay. So what I'll say is, so all the products, Git is what we have done. So today I'll focus on post. Okay. I'm not going to create tasks for everyone. I'm going to create some generic tasks this time, not the exact task IDs for all the different test cases. So I want to do products, categories, stores, and services. Right? Git for this. Git for this. Tell me. So Git for products, post for products, delete for products, and update for products. Put. How many are there? 4 for products, 4 for categories, 4 for stores, and 4 for services. So I'm going to create some tickets here. So I'll say test case development. I'll say get, or I'll say test get method. Products get method. Okay. Test products post method calls. Then test products. Put method calls. Test products delete method calls. Okay. Now, if this task is assigned to someone, that guy is responsible for automating all the product post calls. Previously, what we did, we are all doing get calls and different test cases was assigned to different person. That was not a realistic and test scenario, a realistic way we do things. So I'm saying I want to automate get calls, and if I'm assigning it to you, you're responsible for writing all the get calls, get test cases calls. Okay. And if the new people you're getting overwhelmed, you can leave. Okay. Feeling sleepy or something like that, you can leave. Okay. See, they were just waiting for it. Okay, never mind. So tomorrow if you're coming, you have to come at 2. Okay. All right. Focus. So got it. Now we'll go and create for test categories. Get method calls. Test categories post method calls. This is put method calls. And this is delete method calls. I'm not going to create for more. Let's create it later. But for now, let's keep it to these 8. So I'm going to move these tasks to my sprint 4. Okay. So I will say, okay, I'll move this here. And I will move this here. Okay. I'll move those other tasks as well later. For now, I have these 3 tasks and I want to start my sprint. Okay. So I'll say start sprint. Jira sprint 2, duration is 1 week, start date is this, end date is this. Usually you guys as a tester don't go and do these things. Who does it? Scrum master. I am your scrum master. I'm doing it. Okay. What is sprint goal? So this, in this sprint, our goal is to automate 4 operations for 4 different endpoints. So we have 4 endpoints. Let's see. Product category, stores and services, 4 endpoints. For each 4 endpoints, we have 4 calls. In each call, each endpoints or each calls or method type, we would have different test cases, right? But essentially, we need these 8 tasks, sorry, 12 tasks. 12 or 16? 16 tasks. Okay, and you guys are almost 16. So each one of you will be responsible for taking one Jira ticket. Inside one Jira ticket, there can be multiple test cases. You guys already knew what the test cases are. Test cases you already knew for get, product get. Okay. For others, you need to design test cases. You need to write test cases. For example, post, product post. What are the things which you can test? There are different test cases possible. I will try writing few. You use your own brain and write test cases. Okay. Getting it? For example, post, kya kya ho sakta hai? In the case of post products. So what happens in post? We create a product. So far, so as long, I mean, abhitak, what we have been doing? Getting it. Now we will create it. So what kind of products you can create defines your test cases. The way which you, by which you can create defines your test cases. So you can create test product for different categories. Getting it? So a lot of combinations. See, so categories are there, products are there. So you can do, I'll create a category first, then I create a product, and then I will assign that product with that new category. Right? So many combinations are possible. So I will write few of those important cases, but I want you guys also to apply your brain and write those test cases for yourself inside your task. Whatever test case you are writing, you have to update in the Jira that you're going to do those test cases. Fair enough? Okay. Let me go back. So I will say complete 4 methods for 4 endpoints. Complete test cases for all 4 methods for 4 endpoints. That's my target for this week. So it's going to be tough this time. Okay. And last time also I said, I want your complete support. I cannot do it alone. You guys have to work with me on this. This last week I kept for thoda sa rehearsal ho jaye, thoda sa upko niche karna hai, just so that more trouble now. But this time it's going to be a little bit tough because we are going to learn a lot of things in this. So please focus and please spend more time with it. Okay. Start. So my sprint has started. Now what I'll do is, I want to work on this. So I will put this into in progress. Okay. I'll go back to my Jira. Sorry, go back to my GitHub. So actually what happened? I actually saw your code and I merged few of the code in the master as well. Okay. And your batch is batch 5 actually. I marked it as batch 6. So theek hai, hum change kar lenge naam baad mein. Okay. Now you see API playground, this package log JSON, this is Rupali's doing. Okay, this was not supposed to be here. Okay, anyway, we'll delete it later. So what actually what I did is I created another branch called as master Akash. I created this branch so that I will have some my code which I wanted to write separately. Okay. So what I'll do is I will merge this into master. Okay. And then I will cut my new branch for my Jira ID from master so that no code will be lost, because I wrote some code inside this which I want to retain, and I also want to retain things in master. Okay. So let's see. Let me do this. So I will go and quickly create a pull request. Let's say new pull request. Usually do this step once you want your branch to be merged in the respective branch, target branch. So I want to merge my branch called as Akash here. So you see here it tells you whether it is mergeable or not. Okay. The point is, if I have two files, you are writing some code and someone is in his branch, he is writing some code and you are merging it, then Git will have no problem merging these two files. Second case, you both have written code in the same file, but you have written separately in separate distinguishable separate lines. Then also Git is able to merge it. The problem appears when at the same lines you have made changes, then the conflict occurs. In this case, it's not coming because I have created a separate file altogether. So that is why I'm not getting this merge issue or conflict issue. So I just go and create a pull request. Here, usually you have to go and assign a reviewer. Okay. Good practice is assign someone who is your lead or scrum master, whoever it is, or tech lead. And you can also assign it to your colleagues, because reviews is not something which only the scrum or tech lead or your team lead will do. Reviews is also required from your colleagues, called as peer reviews. Okay. So it's important that you assign it to your, you know, team as well. At least 3-4 names you should put, random people. Next time you're creating PR, create someone, and the person who is being, as soon as someone will put your name, you will get an email. Just go and see. I'll show you how to do a review. So in this case, what I'll say, I will assign it to, let's say, Amol. Okay. I'll say create pull request. So now pull request is created. Okay. Before even creating the pull request, actually this tells you, so let's say you have created a pull request. Files change is where is the place where you can see what changes are you merging. Okay. And this tells you if you're not adding any unnecessary files. So you guys missed that, Rupali and Punima, you guys missed it, missed to check this. So you, before you create a pull request, you always should see what kind of files are being merged. Everyone should do it before they even create pull request. The moment you start, click on new pull request, it tells you the difference. What are the things which you are going to merge? Okay. Once you see, okay, everything is done. Let's say Amol is reviewing it. So you say, okay, I'm not getting why I'm seeing this here. So you click on that line. You say, can you please elaborate? Okay. Or this is wrong coding practice. Please check. And you click here, start a review. Okay. As soon as you do that, the person who has created the pull request will get an email and he will also view the same page. He will say, okay, okay, I agree. So I'll say, okay, I agree. Add a review comment. And then what you do, you go to a local, you make that change and you again check in. You correct that mistake, which the, if you're accepting the review, and you check in the code. Okay. Getting it. This is how we need to work. So as soon as you create your branch, you will create the pull request. I'm going to give a proper review this time. If I'm seeing indentation mistake, if I'm seeing unnecessary imports, if I'm seeing wrong variable names, if I'm seeing wrong logic, wrong assertion, I'm going to put these comments there. You'll get an email, you fix that mistake, and then you will check in the code again after correcting the mistake. Getting it? That's why I'm giving very high emphasis on this. Otherwise, this week also will be lost unnecessarily. Okay, getting it? If you have any questions, ask. Don't just sit and, I know people are feeling sleepy, but still ask. Okay. Now, once this is done, I'll say finish my year review and I will say approve. I cannot click on approve because I created this pull request. So I cannot possibly approve my own pull request. That's a GitHub rule. If this is your pull request, I would have been able to click on approve. So right now I'll simply say comment. And I will say, okay, I will merge it. So right now, since I'm an administrator, I can do it. Usually you will not be able to do a proper merge. Okay, I'll say merge pull request, user administrator privilege, confirm merge. This is like how the full end-to-end pull request works. No one can directly check in their code in the master. It has to be properly approved by proper workflow. And then once that is done, then only things will go inside the master branch. Fair enough? Okay. Now I'll go back to code. Now, since whatever we are doing is a new project altogether, it's a new sprint, right? I will create a branch called as develop. Okay. Usually in the real-time environment, there are usually two branches, two primary branches. One is the default branch, let's call it as master. In master, whatever code is in the master is always has to be 100% bug-free, issue-free, problem-free, working code. One branch below that is a development branch or develop branch. Develop branch is the branch that's actually a staging branch. Staging branch means that you do all kind of merging everything in the develop branch. All pull requests will always go into the point to the develop branch. Okay. Once everything is working in the develop branch, when everything is final, we put that develop branch to the master branch. That is the usual process. Okay. So from next time, once you do your task, you will create a pull request for develop, not master. So next time you're going to create a pull request, it should be, I want to merge this branch to the develop branch. Don't create a pull request for the master. I will reject it. So always create a pull request for develop. Once everything is working in the develop, then I'm going to put that into the master later. Once the sprint is over, I'll say, okay, everything is working now. Let's put things in the master. Okay. So right now, let's assume I'm working on this task called as test products post method calls. So let's assume I'm working on this. So I'm going to create a ticket for this. So first what I'll do is I'll create a develop branch. Okay. Now from develop branch, I'm going to create another branch for my task. Okay. Getting it? So if you're creating a task, you should have a cut from develop, not master. Are you guys getting this? Forget master. Consider your master is developed now. Okay. Now I will say I'm here and I will say this is Jira 40. So I'll say Jira 40. Okay. So post methods. Okay. Jira 40 post method test cases. TC. Okay. And always make sure you see from develop here. Always make sure, because sometimes people make this mistake. How? I'll tell you that mistake so that you don't make it. So what they do is they are on specific branch. Like for example, they are here. And then you do this and you do this. Then it will try to create this branch from this branch. So the actual code will not come. You always have to cut your branch from develop branch because that's where the actual code is. Okay. So I will remove this. I will go to develop first. I'll go to develop. And then after I am on develop, I can do this. By the way, this creation of new branches can also be done from command line. But I'm not exposing you to that right now because another layer of complexity from Git side would come. So let's create your branch from here. That is more foolproof. Okay. Create branch. Where is Jira? So Jira 40. Create branch this from develop. So once this is done, next step is, since you already have your project exported here, right? So I can now start working on it. So I will go here right now. See, this is pointing to master-akash. I'll right click on it. I'll go to team. So to work with Jira, you have two options. Either you can directly do from command line or you can do from Eclipse. From, if you're using Eclipse, it's relatively very easy to do. If you're doing from command line, it's a bit complicated because you need to know the syntaxes. And in interview, they always ask the tough things. So that's why I recommend always use command line. Because if you will know, I know Git, I am able to use Git, but not from command line, then you will not be able to answer few of the questions the interviewer might ask. Okay. So stop doing this. Stop using doing things from Eclipse. Rather, go in the command line and do it from there. Okay. Otherwise, you will not able to revise those syntax. You will just remember them, but you will forget. You will forget when actual interview will come, because truth comes out when you are giving an interview. Always. You cannot fool an interviewer. Always truth will come out. If you have done it, you will be able to say. If you have not done it, you cannot fool the person. Okay. So what I'll do is, I'll go to the command line. This is my workspace. This is my project. I'll right click. I'll new terminal at folder. In Windows, you have to go to that specific folder. Okay. And then I'll say Git. So first command, usually what I do is Git status. Okay, that's usually the first command which I always, you should always say. This is saying I have modified this, whatever it is, I'm going to say Git stash. Why? Because if I try to do a checkout now, it won't allow me. Getting it? Because if I'm doing a checkout, let's see, let's try to do. Let's see if I'm able to. Git checkout. Okay, first I need to do a Git pull. Because I have done something in the server, I need to bring it to my local first. When I say Git pull, whatever made changes in whatever branches happening on the server, everything will come down to my local. Okay, so I'll say Git pull first. So see, it's saying a develop branch has been created, a Jira 40 post has been created, something has merged in the master, you know, some IDs it's saying. This got changed to this. Whatever happened on the server has come down here now. And I want to do what? I want to switch to my branch. So I'll say Git branch hyphen R. When I say hyphen R, it will list down all the branches which are there. Okay, you see, if I click this. So these are the branches which have been created so far on the server. How many branches are there? 21, 24, 27, Master, Akash, Rahul ki do hai. I don't know why. Right, so I want to merge, I want to switch to this branch, which is Kangi 40, this one, Jira 40, right? So I will say Git checkout paste 40. Okay, now it's saying it has switched. But it is also saying that these two files have been deleted in the previous branch. Okay. And this was modified. It shouldn't be doing it. There's something which I have missed. Let me check. Okay. Because there is no change coming down to this file. So it didn't find any conflict or risk of overwriting something. That's the reason it has immediately checked out. Whenever you're checking out and Git sees a risk of something being overwritten, at that point it will always say, I will not switch it. So when you say Git checkout from a specific branch to a specific branch, and if you made some changes in that previous branch and there's a risk of that being overwritten, in that case, Git will not allow you to check out. So what command you will run then? You will run Git stash. Either you run this or you will say Git reset hard. Why we are doing this? git stash or git reset hard. These two commands are required if you want to eliminate all the changes which you have done. Getting it? So this, when you will use it, so you are doing something and something you messed up, something is wrong. So what you do is you store your changes somewhere. You keep your changes somewhere in a separate text file or somewhere, and you do this command git stash or git reset hard. So what will happen? It will come down to the place from where you started messing things up. Okay, so you are here, you are doing something, kachra ho gaya kuch yahan pe, and you are very confused what to do next. So you take help of these commands, git stash or git reset hard. It will take you down to the original right version of your software or project. But these two commands, not two commands, so git reset hard will remove everything. So there is a risk of everything being gone from your, from whatever you have done. So hamesha dhyan rakho usko kahin, agar aapko usko store karna hai, so keep it out, keep it somewhere in your whatever code you have written, keep it somewhere else, let it come to here and then put your changes back there. You can also do that from git stash. So in that case, git stash mein wo apne aap hi save kar leta hai, but let's not do that for now. Okay, I will always say use git stash, because in git stash it will not eliminate these things, it will remove it from here, put it somewhere else. So your work will always be saved, it nothing will be deleted. Okay, so git reset hard you should use in the cases where you're absolutely sure that I don't want these messed up things, I want to delete everything. So use git reset hard. Cases where you think messed up things but you want to store whatever work you have done, then use git stash. Fair enough? Any questions here? Okay, let me explain on board. I'm pausing. So what I'm doing right now is I'm going to discard these files later, because these are the files which you guys have created and put in your code, but that's not up to the mark. So I'm going to create a proper folder structure. So one is test case products. Inside this, let me create a folder called as dot get. So all the get I will put here. Okay, finish. Then all the post, all the put here, all the delete here. Okay, similarly if I want to do or whoever is doing services or whoever is doing for example stores or categories, for them the folder will be like this. So test case dot categories. Okay, then inside that same folder structure should be there. Dot get, dot post. I'll create it later and I'll push it. So you will whenever you start your work, you're going to cut your branch from develop. So all this folder structure will already be there in your system. You don't have to create the packages. All you need to do is to create files, test case files. Okay, and this time there will only be one file for one kind of calls or endpoint. So in this case, let's say this is my file, so I am going to move it inside get. So in this case I will only have this file here. So whoever is going to do a get now, all their test cases should be inside this. So this is T01 get request for all products. We have done so many test cases, right? Everything should be inside this particular test class files. Okay, now what you guys missed, let me see what you guys did. You guys did this. So response given base URI, I think Amol created this, or who created this? Sandeep, you created this, right? So we did this, someone I think did this as well, right? So response given base URI when get this, actual status code, get status code, what is this, and you just put an assertion on status code. We need few more assertions. Okay, let me show you how. So I'll go and click stop this, get products. So see how I have done it. I have broken down the statements. So we had given when, then, right? When you do a given statement and you run something before when, you get a request specification object. So three main kind of object is what we have here. Second is, once you do a get, you get a response object. Okay. And once you put a then, you get a validatable response. So three main type of objects are here. If you don't want to use it, you directly do given when then. Internally, these are handled. But why I'm dividing this? Because these are important. If you are going into a Cucumber environment, then you need to divide these. So if let me show you. So when we did API automation via Cucumber, I had to divide these steps. So you see response here, so response request specification here, response here. Because we need to share these objects across different methods. That's the reason I need to divide it. So I have divided this here also. Here, I don't have to divide it, but to make you understand what each item or each given when then is returning, I have divided this. You should also do the same way. So don't just do given dot when dot then, right? Divide it first. So I divide this as response specification. Then response is response specification dot when dot get. So this returns a response. Then validatable response, response valid, response dot then. Okay. Now once I get this, this means the response which I have, I can validate it. These all are rest assured, by the way. It has nothing to do with the API per se. It is all about how you do things in rest assured. Okay. Now response validatable response, I can use methods to assert it. So first assertion is always status code. So I've written response validate dot assert that dot status code. What is second validation? You will check the body. What is the content of that request? Getting it, understand it, or think it in a test case perspective. What will you test in an API? So you hit an API, it will return you something. You need to validate that. What are the two validation points there? First is what status code it has returned. Second is what content it has returned. And is it the expected content which it has returned? Okay. So first thing I will check via, status code. And second is via body. So if I do assert that and if I do dot, I see lot of items here. And rest assured is really very good in terms of documentation. So if you click on something, it will tell you exactly what that particular method is used for and how will you use it. It tells you everything. It's very good documentation. So body has different overloaded methods here. So by this, rest assured wants to tell you that you can validate the body in different ways. And based on what you want to validate and how you want to validate it, you need to select these body, select these methods. So first is, not they're different, I'm not going to explain all, but I'll only explain two important things. One is, you do a body and you can write some kind of matcher here. What is a matcher? Anyone knows? What is a matcher? Hamcrest matcher, right? What is Hamcrest? Hamcrest is a library. You remember you do this, for example, you write assert dot assert that, right? These are test ng methods for assertion. What is assertion? Assertion is the last point of a test case, which tells you whether test case is pass or fail. Okay. Assertion is pass, then the test case becomes pass in the report. Test assertion fails, then test case fails in the report. Now rest assured comes with a assertion library of its own. Not of its own, it borrows it from a library called as Hamcrest assertion. So if you're using TestNG, if you're using JUnit, doesn't matter to rest assured. Rest assured says, if you're using any kind of framework, you can use my own assertion called as Hamcrest assertion. Uska library maine top mein import kiya hua hai. Import static org Hamcrest matches. For this, you don't have to. Okay, by the way, let me tell you this thing as well straight away. In the POM, sorry. Where's my project? This is my project, right? I see only TestNG and rest assured. Okay. I don't see this because I haven't added any dependency of it. So how come I'm able to use this? Bolo bolo. So this is called as transitive dependency. This is a Maven concept. So let's say I'm creating a project. My project is dependent on a separate library. Okay. So what happens is, in the form of my project, I will mention that particular repository or particular dependency. And if that form, my project form, I am giving it to someone and he is using it, what will happen? My project will go there, as well as my transitive dependency project will also go there. So it will import both the libraries. And that's the reason I'm able to use this here, because the moment I wrote this here, this rest assured has the form of this rest assured had dependence, Hemke's dependency in its form. Okay. As soon as I written this, rest assured library came, as well as all the dependent or dependencies libraries also came into my system. Getting it? It's called as transitive dependency. Maven concept. Anyway, so I'll be here and I'm going to use this Hemcrest matcher. So when I say dot body, it tells me matcher. You see matcher, so chota hai, but if you can't see, you can see it later. Here, there's a matcher written here. This matcher simply means Hemcrest matcher. Okay. Hemcrest library, what they've done is they've created small, small methods. Contain strings, has size. So I've written some few things at the top as well. Equal to, contain string, has item, has size. You can also see those methods here. This is Hemcrest Java doc URL. All the Hemcrest libraries which are there are written here, and how to use it also there. All of, for example, equal to. Equal to, right? So telling you how to use it. Assert that foo equal to foo, right? New string, how to use it, it's telling you everything. See guys, this is a new thing for you, I know. This can be a little bit complicated to understand, but once you start using it, it's easy, trust me. Okay, right. Foo bar is what the coding standard they use for dummy data. Okay. Questions? It's confusing, not confusing, interesting, sleepy, boring. Show me some response. Okay, that's fine. I'll just finish it off, this first part. Okay, maybe we'll continue tomorrow. I'm seeing people getting exhausted. Just few more things. So this body, there are two or three applications for it. So one is, you can put a matcher directly here, right? So in this case, I put a direct matcher called as body contains string, and I'll put what I am expecting. Usually if you are doing this from TestNG, what you will do? You'll get in response, convert to a string, and then put in the assertion, assert dot assert that, right? And then you'll put the equal to there, expected actual. What rest assured is saying, you don't have to do it. You can directly do just by using my library. So you don't have to put in any JUnit or TestNG assertions. You can use my own library, which I'm using, which I'm relying on Hemcrest. So here, just by writing this body and contains string, I don't have to write any other statement of assertion. It's directly doing my assertion here. So assert that body contains string. So what will happen in the response? It will check for Duracell, this AA batteries. If it's there, it will pass. If it's not there, the statement will fail. The test case will fail. So my assertion, I can easily put it here directly. Okay. Second thing is, or last thing is, now you want to do some complex assertion and you're not able to do this using this. What a complex assertion, which we discussed last time. It's a big JSON. You need to fetch all the product names or all the categories. For example, there was a test case in Git where you wanted to do what? You want to check whether ascending order is coming or not, or descending order is coming or not. What is the right approach to put a validation is, you put a get in ascending, it will return your list, sorry, return your complete JSON. Then you will fetch all the items, all the prices. So fetching all the prices, you need to bring that into a list. Okay, see how I have done it. I'm saying response dot JSON path dot get list data dot name. So this will do what? This will fetch all the name from the JSON. Let me show you. Let me run it. So I'll say right click, run as. See, it has written everything. You see this data? Inside this data, I had this name. So it has written all the names. Let's say I want to have all the prices. So I'm telling you a cue or hint for automating that ascending descending order. So we have a price also somewhere, right? So where is the price? So this is data. Price, right? And I want to fetch price of all the products which are written. What will say? Data dot price. Price, right? I will right click, click here, run as test ng test. So you see, it has returned me a list of all the prices. How to get that inside list? Response.json path dot get, and this is your JSON path. Sorry, response.json path dot get list. This is your JSON path. This will return you a string of, sorry, list of strings. And then you will write your own logic. Okay, your own logic to see if whatever you have written, whatever is being written, is in ascending order or descending order. So custom assertions is, this is how you will do. Okay, I'll just show you example. One more minute. So this is here, not basics, yeah, sorry. Kumbh API automation. You see this? This was product prices will be returned in descending order. Okay, what I did, response JSON path, get list, data dot price. I got this inside a list. And then I am using a method, or sorry, a logic. I'm grouping it. Okay, I'm comparing. Getting it? I'm comparing the list. If I'm not finding it in a right order, I'm breaking it and saying false. And I'm putting a logic in at the bottom that if this is false, then say price is not written in descending order. This kind of logic is what you need to write. Whoever is doing this get request and whoever is going to get the get request task, they need to make sure that they are writing a test case where they are also putting right assertions. So don't think you get too easy. Get will not be easy now. You will have to write, hit it, and you need to get the assertions and you need to write proper logic to validate it. Okay. We have in the previous batches, we have done this task. Rahul have done it. Vaibhav has done it. But their code is not in the repository. Okay? Your code is in the repository, my repository. You are pushing your code in your repository only, right? And you have done this, all these assertions. Done it? So what we can do is you can send me your code again. I will create a sample project somewhere near so that you can reference with it. You take some reference. If you're stuck somewhere, you can take some reference. Okay? Fair enough. So I'm not going to continue more. It's 5 already. And simply because you guys are super bored. So I'll not continue. Okay.